So, our next talk will be by Alexander on Salsa and GitLab. Welcome.
So, hello, or as we in Germany say, moin. Welcome to Hamburg and my talk. I want to talk today about some things about GitLab and Salsa, some features we have, some Salsa-specific features, some GitLab-specific features that are not so well known yet. So I hope they will be used more in the future. And we will start with a short introduction: what is GitLab, what is Salsa, who I am, and so on. So who am I? Alexander Wirth, also known as Fomar. I am a Debian contributor since 1999, Debian developer since 2003. I also have several roles in Debian, like I'm a list master for something like 15 years. I'm the backports FTP master. And I was a former Alioth admin, which preceded Salsa, and now I'm the Salsa admin. For Salsa, I'm not alone. There's also Bastian Blank, alias Waldi, and Jörg Jaspert, alias Ganev, which are also Salsa admins. And we managed to introduce, let's go with my boards. When I'm not doing Debian, I'm an open source consultant at Creditive, which is an open source consultant company here in Germany. I have two girls. And when I find time, I also do tabletops and role-playing games. Short commercial, we need you. So if you want to work as an open source consultant in Germany, please get in touch with us. We are looking for you. So let's come back to my talk. There's GitLab. GitLab is basically a functional fork of GitHub, which was developed by a small Israel company and which was bought by Microsoft a few months ago. And it's Ruby on Rails based. It's pretty much scalable. It's splitted all those functionality in several components, like Gitali, which is a backend just for Git, which hosts your Git repositories and provides an API to the front end. There's, of course, the Ruby on Rails front end and load balancer and so on. It's basically a GitHub clone, which means it started with more or less one-to-one front-end compatibility to GitHub. But over the time, it evolved, and they added more and more features that you can't find in GitHub. Whereas light, there's also dark. GitLab is open core, which means you have an open source base. Which is what we use, and but there are also paid enterprise and ultimate versions that you can buy for your company, which has more enterprise-like features. That was a big discussion in Debian when we decided to use GitLab, but in the end, GitLab was the best thing we could use. Basically, it was ready. Which was something which the other tools didn't work at that time. And also the company behind GitLab offered us to change the license to be more compatible with us, which means they removed their contributors license agreement. And so also helped us a lot in getting GitLab into Debian, which means they pay several packages, two or three, I think, which are paid just to package GitLab for Debian. We don't use package GitLab, but that's another story I won't tell today. Back to Salsa. Salsa is the Debian Git service. When moving away from Alioth, we decided just to keep Git from all those version control systems we had in the past, which were 11 or 12, Darks, VCS, Darks, CVS, Bazaar and other even more obscure version control systems. But since Git more or less won the war, Salsa is Git only. Salsa is based on GitLab. We manage it as a source build via Ansible. There's also a link behind the presentation where you can find all the stuff we use to set up Salsa. By now we have something like 5,200 users, which makes us probably the biggest GitLab installation out of GitLab itself. Yeah, the Drupal guys have more. I heard they have more. The Drupal project also switched to GitLab in April, and they have even more than we have. I'm not sure if they have that much size in their repos, but yeah, we have also nearly 32,000 projects, something like 600 in groups, and which makes it a big installation. All of it is hosted on one machine, so we don't use any of the scalability features yet. There's plenty of room for improving things, but by now, for most things except the Debian security repos, it's working fine. But that's a problem of those repos, not of GitLab. So I want to talk today about some features. But the slides are a bit unsorted, so I'm starting with one of the more advanced features, which is the API. GitLab has very, very good API, which covers nearly everything GitLab can do. I can only recommend to dive into it if you want to do don't want to use the web front end. The web front end is mostly nice. It has some glitches, however, it's most of the time useful. But if you don't think it's useful, or you have to automate things, or want to do more complicated things, you can use the API. I see that URL is wrong. You please replace the EE with CE, which brings it to the edition, brings it to the core edition and not to the enterprise edition, where the enterprise edition has some more API endpoints than the open source edition has. We do a lot of user support for Salsa. And please do me a favor and don't start implementing tools with using curl or wget on the command line to do complicated things with the API. It's impressively hard to get things like efficient searching or pagination, right, in curl, which always brings us into problems when we have scripts that queries just everything, do a grep, use that query everything again, and so on. We have some experts that always try to do that. Please use a library. Please do me a favor, use a proper library. If you want to use the API, everything starts with creating your API token. Those tokens can be set with expiration, they can have limited rights, and you don't have to use your username or password, and you should not use your username or password if you do anything with the API. It is possible to use the password, but please don't do. After you have such an API token, you can use can do authenticated requests. Because it's easier for the talk, I used curl. Please don't do that. doing an authenticated request is easy. Just give it a header with a private token and your token, and then your requests are authenticated. It's important. If you are authenticated, you get proper error messages, like a project doesn't exist, or you don't have access to a project. For some privacy reasons, the API returns not found error for nearly everything, even if you don't have permission, just don't have permission to see it. If you are authenticated, you get proper error messages. So use authentication all the time. check for a project. If you want to check for a project, please do not use the API. You don't have to use the API. You can just call that call the URL of the project, and you see that if that project exists. You can, of course, call the API, the project's endpoint. But if you do that, you will get a big answer, which consists all of all projects, including several meta information, which you don't want, and which will generate a request in several megabytes. And if you do that too often, the machine doesn't want to talk to you again. So just check it with the normal URL. You can, of course, do that with the API. If you know, if you read the documentation, not if you don't read the documentation very good, you will try to get your project by an ID. Every object has an ID, like a group ID, a project ID, user ID, and so on. You can query every project by ID, but you can also query projects by name. It's that thing. A name consists of usually a group or a namespace and the project itself. So if you use that convention, you don't have to have to know the ID. When we started with Salsa, most people tried to just query the project endpoint, get all projects, looked for their ID, and then started over. But you don't have to do that. If you know what project you're looking for, you can go directly to the API. Yeah, that convention, the person 2F is just the dash in encoded form. If you don't know JQ yet, I can only recommend you to that tool. It's JSON processor for the command line. You can use JQ for everything you want to do with JSON. Querying, looping, whatever you want over JSON objects. So that JQ expression just gives you the description field with which was Debian Security Tracker. You can also subscribe to issues. That's the obscure ID. But you can also use a name there. Please, again, do not use curl. There are libraries for nearly every language, like Python, Perl, Go, or Ruby. I used all of them. All of them work for probably everything you want. So that's the API part. If you don't want to use, if you want to use the API but don't want to use it on your own, there's a tool that's called Salsa. It's including dev scripts, and therefore it's probably already on your system. And it helps you with doing common things like forking a project, creating merge requests, push your repo to an upstream repository, or just clone something. I'm pretty sure the guys that written that tool will accept patch requests, patches or feature requests to improve it. So, da ist meine Star. So if you want to use the API but don't want to use it on your own, use Salsa. It should get you the most features you want you need. GitLab CI. I will not go too deep into GitLab CI because I was probably a good talk in the morning just about GitLab CI. I wasn't able to look at it. So if you want to get deeper into GitLab CI and Salsa CI, where I'm coming through in a few minutes, please look at the talk in the morning. However, what is GitLab CI? GitLab CI is a CI, common integration tool, a continuous integration tool, which enables you to build, test, and maybe even deploy your code So you can use it to test your packages if they build. You can use your packages if they build on obscure architectures. Only if you provide your own build service. We, as in Salsa, provide Google Cloud-based runner, which you can use. That's a Docker-based. We have plenty of dollars from Google to spend on it. So if you want to build your packages with Debian, with Salsa, just use it. You can test your packages with Lintian or other tools like PewParts. You can even build websites, documentation, and provide them also via Salsa, which is something we'll talk about later. So have a look into it. It's something new, which is not very common in Debian yet, but we should use it more. Every build and every test gives us more quality. GitHub CI configuration is pretty easy. You usually have a YAML file where you can do things, like run a script before you want to do something, and then you can do build steps as much as you want. Like building the package, like building your source code, like running Lintian, running whatever you want. And you can also provide artifacts. If you do that, you have a web front end where you have so-called pipelines where you can just run your things. We have here a multi-stage pipeline which just builds code and then runs several tests, and PewParts in that case failed. You can get notifications out of it. You can create issues out of it if you want. There are several options you have with those CIs. When developing your CI file, there's also a GitLab CI linter in the web front end, where you can just paste your GitLab CI file in and then press validate and check if your syntax is correct and what GitLab thinks is what is in your GitLab CI file. But you don't have to use it directly. You can just use Salsa CI. Salsa CI is a wonderful project that tries to get all those fiddling details out of the maintainers by providing ready-to-use GitLab CI pipeline, which just does everything you probably need for packaging quality work. This pipeline is provided by the Salsa CI team, which also means if you have problems with it that are not Salsa specific, please talk to the Salsa CI team. They will help you. It's Debian package building specific, so don't try to build RPMs with it or something else. It can also create apt repositories for testing those packages. Just a hint from my side, Salsa is not built to be in a replacement for PPA or whatever, so please don't use those things to provide packages to end users. They're great for testing and developing, but please, this is not an official package store. And it also covers several quality management tools like Lintian, auto-packing tests, PewParts, and probably a lot of others. There's a lot of documentation. Please check it out if you're interested. What does it look like? It's also pretty easy. All you have to do, if you want to build a package, all you have to do is this. Use the right, they provide a Docker image, which you can use. It's probably based on Debian Unstable. I'm not exactly sure. If you do that, it just builds your package, runs whatever it has, if there are auto package tests included, if we run auto package tests, and so on. That's good, I know. And then it provides you with your dev. There are also some options like creating those repos and so on. But as said before, please check out the documentation of Salsa CI. There are also other things you can do with GitLab. Which is coming more and more into Debian is our merge requests. So now with a decent front end and GitHub-like, GitHub-style-like Git repositories, people use fork repo, create a fetch, and create a merge request. You can do that from the web front end, but you don't have to. You can also use Git itself to just create those merge requests. So if you have a forked repository, you can just git push with a git option, merge request create, and then we'll get a merge request of whatever you pushed against the original repository. So you don't have to use the web front end. If you want to merge your request in a different branch, so the target branch on the upstream repository, you can also do this via a push request. If you want to do this in two steps, you can just do this in one step. If you want to create a merge request against a different target branch, you can just do this via get. You can also update things like, let's create a merge request when our pipeline succeeds. That's an option. You can also do that in the web front end, but you can also do this via git. And again, if you want to do this in both steps, just use those both options. Another nice feature, which is not so common known, are issue boards. You can use those issue boards to create Kanban or Scrum boards for teams or yourself to manage to-dos or tasks for tasks you want to do. You can also use this for issues in your packages, but I don't recommend to do that. Why? We have our bug tracking official bug tracker, and it is not planned or, from my side, wanted to replace it with GitLab issues. Our bug tracker has its problems, but it's great, and there are no plans to replace it. That's the reason why several projects have disabled the issue tracker from GitLab, but you can also create just project just to keep those to-dos if you don't want to create issues on your own packaging project. Those issue boards are a great tool to manage responsibilities, check what needs to be done for the next release, whatever. You can also manipulate those issue boards via commit requests. So if you think the commit you are doing is solving something, you can just add it in your commit message. I have an example later, and then those issues get closed. And that's also a nice feature from GitLab. Yeah, as said, you can manipulate stuff by committing code. I will not go too deep into the GitLab-specific things, but we are here in Debian, so I will refer to Debian-specific things. We have a service, also we, as in Salsa, we have a service, it's webhook salsa debian.org. That's a generic daemon we have written, which is can be enhanced via plugins to provide things on webhooks. Why webhooks? In the path, you just added hooks to your Git repository for security reasons. That's not allowed anymore. So the preferred way to automate things on push or on merge is a webhook. Not everyone wants to run a webhook, therefore we created that service. So if you want to get anything automated via webhook, and you are able to write a little bit Ruby, just provide us with a patch and a new plugin for our webhook server, and we will host it for you. And then every project can use it. By now, we have two of those plugins available. The first one is a closed plugin, which is primarily used by the web team, which can close bugs on commit. So if you add a closes yada yada message in your commit message, like you did before for a normal changelog, It was the closed bugs in our BTS. So please don't use it in your normal packaging repo. If you want to do something in your normal packaging repo, you can use tag pending, which just marks a bug as pending. So after you that the user can see you have fixed your bug with that commit, but you don't close it yet because you haven't uploaded it yet. So again, please contribute those webhooks to the API. Yes?
Sorry, just to be sure. So those hooks are for bugs in Debian BTS, not bugs in issues in Salsa?
Yes. If you have GitLab specific issues, that's already implemented in GitLab itself. So if you use issues, whatever number, it will close it for you. There's just check out the GitLab documentation for that for that things. So we don't need a webhook for that.
Ah, okay, thanks.
Yeah, provide us with a plugin, and we will happily integrate it. All those plugins have also options like stick to specific branch names or other things. So there's also documentation. There's a link behind the presentation where you can check out the options those webhooks have. In the future, we want to make some proper integrations. GitLab has a fairly new feature of integrations where you can provide just code and web front end Ruby on Rails code to provide real option buttons and for specific features so that you don't have to use webhooks. But yeah, we need time and they are fairly under-documented, which doesn't make it easy just to implement something. Pages. You can also just use Salsa to host pages, documentation, blogs, whatever you like, as long as it's more or less Debian related or open source related. Within pages Debian.net, you get with every project you get a subdomain on pages Debian.net, which is presented in the web front end. And if you create a GitLab CI job with a specific pages task, where you copy files in, those files will end in your web service. Using this is pretty easy. I have an example with Hugo, which is my favorite Go-based block compiler. Yeah, you just import a Hugo-based Hugo doc container, then you call Hugo on every branch that is not master, and then you call Hugo on the master branch. Also this is a test step, so only if the your test works, it will go to the next step, and then it will just publish the pages you have in your public directory to pages DBNet. So it's pretty easy. You can also use static files where you just copy them to the pages module, and then you're done and you have a web page. You can also do more complicated things like Jekyll, Hugo, Pelican, whatever block compilers exist, or whatever you like to generate documentation. So, some unsought goodies. GitLab has a feature of two-factor authentication. I can only recommend to use two-factor authentication on Salsa. Please do so. If you don't have any hardware device like a YubiKey, please use any TOTP compatible second-factor authentication tool like Google Authenticator or whatever exists outside. But if you get lost of your second factor, you can reset your and you get lost of your recovery codes. You can also generate new ones via SSH. So just use that SSH, and you get a bunch of new recovery codes, which you can also use if you are somewhere else where you don't have access to your mobile phone or whatever you use for a second factor. These are valid one-time passwords used for your login. You can also create repos by pushing to GitLab, but there's a warning, a big disclaimer on it. For privacy reasons, all those repositories will be private after creation. So if you do that in the Debian group, where you are not the not namespace owner, you will end with a repository you can't access later. We can change that. You not. That's something for the namespace owners. That's the future feature for not providing sensitive data to the outside if used in enterprise context. And we have a policy of not changing code in GitLab if we don't have to, and that's not important enough to provide a bottle patch. You can of course create an issue at the GitLab for the GitLab guys with a patch where you add a global option where we can disable it. But by now nobody has done it yet. So coming to the end. It's now about you. I'm not the only one using Salsa. So do you have anything to share about GitLab or Salsa I haven't mentioned, where you think it's important, nice, and other people should know? Nobody? Really?
Thanks for doing that.
So just to confirm what you said about the talk this morning, it was an interesting talk, and I think it's really great that we have these plug-and-play pipelines where we can have all the quality checks, usual quality checks, that are done before uploading to the archive. So thanks to the team for doing that.
I was just going to add that in my talk at, what, at 6, and when it was supposed to be, I will be showing one of the uses of GitLab CI for a Debian derivative which we're making. So yeah, if anyone's interested, you can come and see.
Thanks.
I'm having a problem to upload photos in JPG format. I can't upload photos like that, Jocelyn, in PNG.
Create an issue.
Yeah.
I'm not you aware of anyone else that wanted to upload mobile phone specific pictures. So just create an issue and we have a look into it.
Yeah, just when I'm writing an issue, because if I just upload a photo as a file, a normal file, it can go, but as attached in an issue, I can't.
We have to look into it.
Okay, nice.
So with my experience with GitLab, it's a huge resource hog, and I wanted to ask what's like the resource uses of such a huge instance.
It's not that much. We have really? Something about 8 cores on a Ganiti cluster and 32 gigabytes of RAM and yeah, half of a terabyte on hard disks.
That's actually not too bad.
Things got better with the new hashing algorithm. GitLab 11 something migrated from having one GitLab repository per project on disk to something like a hash farm, where Gitly just knows about every Git repository and the commits in it, the Git objects in it. So if you fork a 40 gigabyte repo 10 times, you won't end up with 40 gigabytes, just with 10 gigabytes plus the delta. That's yeah. Something new, which also helped. And yeah, but I don't have the impression that it's that much resource hog, because it just works for us.
Right.
Unless people query those things like slash projects every 5 minutes. But if you work carefully with it, it works.
And do you have stats about the usage of GitLab CI and how much infrastructure it uses?
I will be able to provide such stats. Yeah.
Thanks.
Okay, so that's all feedback. Documentation. We have documentation. It's all, yeah, you can't see it. We have documentation on our wiki. So please read the documentation if you find something is missing. If a writer says a ticket, or even better, provide those documentation. The people running those services are usually really bad in writing documentation. So please help us to improve those this documentation for other users. If you need access to those slides, just check out that URL. It's, yeah, within Salsa and my personal user account. So, yeah, it's probably 2019, I hope. And not 2018. Otherwise, I will rename the repository. So, yeah, that's all from my side. Are there any questions?
Is it working?
Okay. Okay, please stand up. Do you think that we could add runners for different architectures? I don't know, Google Cloud doesn't have any other architecture.
Everyone is, of course, free to provide those runners. So our user we rely on sponsoring, and we didn't got any offer to get those other architectures sponsored. The usual problem with other architectures is, yeah, you don't have any service provider that have those architectures as as a service. It's even hard to get an ARM server, and even more harder to get other architectures. So I don't see that in the future. If you want to provide such a runner, you can of course do that.
And register them as shared as well. Yeah.
Probably. If we get root, yes. Otherwise, you will have to just offer it as the usual runner. Okay.
So to follow on from that, so Debian's already maintaining all those architectures, and we have porters to log in and do the manual testing runs. What is the possibility of going well? Can we let Salsa run runners on those? I mean, is that crazy?
You should have asked the DSA.
Well, exactly.
If it's crazy. I don't think that they are very keen on letting other users and Salsa, also basically other users on those buildies, and I don't think they will.
It seems to me that recreating all that infrastructure again, just so that we can run Salsa tests for other architectures, is kind of stupid, because we've gone to all the trouble of creating it for this purpose. It seems sensible to work out a scheme with DSA.
Yes, on one side, yes, but you don't want to have any content uploaded by anyone on GitLab, on Salsa, running our buildies. So
I was thinking the porter boxes rather than the buildies, but yeah, I mean the point is that that's restricted to Debian developers and Salsa isn't.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, that's the main problem, isn't it?
It's basically a public service, and I see security problems
mm-hmm.
when people are just able to execute code on those boxes, even if they are isolated by LXC or Docker or whatever.
Fair enough.
Okay.
Any further questions? Let's check in IRC. Doesn't look like. So let's thank Alex again.